Mrs. Shobana Subramanian graduated with a gold medal and additionally was the best outgoing student in her Bachelor's of Architecture batch. Mrs. Shobana, working as a senior architect at the Engineering Design Research Center, L&T Construction, India's largest construction company. She has worked on various projects including hospitals, office buildings, residential, recreational to institutional projects. She has also attended 4 national conferences, 1 international conference, and an international Indo-French workshop initiated by the UN Heritage on the urban morphology and architectural typology of the Karaikudi heritage, Chettinad.
Welcome to UGC lecture series for BE Architecture. In this lecture, we'll be looking at the subject Building Materials 2, Unit 5, Paint and Varnishing in Timber. This is lecture 1 for the Unit 5. In this lecture, we'll be introduced to paints, what are paints, what it is composed of, how it is manufactured, and what are the characteristics of a good paint. So, paints. Paints is a colored substance which is spread over a surface and dries to leave a thin decorative and or protective coating. What is the function of paints? Paints basically protect, preserve and pretty or beautify. So, protection. Protection of the part surfaces from the environmental factors like oxygen and other chemically active gases and moisture, dissolved salts, chemicals, temperature, bacteria, fungi, insects. Also, protection also involves protection from corrosion and weathering, which is the most important aspect of protection. And in a way, changing the surface property, like making a surface anti-friction or increasing the hardness of a surface or lessening the electrical conductivity of a surface by painting on it, that also in a way gives protection to the surface. Now, aesthetic appearance. Now, preserving. Any surface that is painted on is also preserved. For example, a timber surface that is painted on is better preserved than a timber surface that is unpainted on. So, preservation comes in hand with protection, and preservation also increases the life of the surface or timber that is just painted on. Now, when it comes to pretty or beautifying, or in other words, aesthetic, increasing the aesthetic value of the painted surface. Aesthetic appearance provided by the paint color and sheen, for example, satin finish or glossy finish, that looks better than the natural surface how if it was left raw, and providing a desired ability of reflection or absorption of heat and light. Also, by rendering a color to the painted surface, an identification or psychological relation of products according to the color of paint happens. For example, if you see, when you see a wall with red and white stripes, you automatically relate it to the temples. Usually temple walls are striped like that. So, identification happens, this color belongs to that, that kind of psychological identification also happens. Now, what is a paint composed of? Paints composed of majorly 3 components. First is pigments, and second is additives, and third is vehicle or carrier. This vehicle or carrier consists of solvents and binder. Let's start with vehicles. Vehicles can be consist of only the binder or binder plus solvent. Binder is also called resin and solvent is also called dilutant. Now, when the vehicle is composed of the binder, or if it is necessary to thin the binder with a dilutant like solvent or water, it is a combination of binder plus dilutant. In this case, once the paint has dried or cured, very nearly of all the dilutant has evaporated and only the binder is left on the coated surface. So, now we'll look into detail into what is a binder and what is a solvent. Starting with binder, binders are also called resin. Basically, binder, as the name suggests, binds or glues ingredients, pigments, additives, solvents, everything of paint together. Now, the binder is the film forming component of paint. It is the only component that is always present among all the various types of paints. Now, many binders are too thick to be applied and they must be thinned. Now, this type of thinner, if present, varies with the type of binder. For certain type of binder, you need certain type of water-based thinners, and for certain type of binders, you need oil-based thinners. So this binder imparts properties such as gloss, durability, flexibility and toughness to the paint. Also, it provides adhesion to the substrate. Substrate as in the paint surface to be painted on. Binder also provides durability and resistance properties such as UV resistance, moisture resistance, chemical resistance, stain resistance, fade, chalk and block resistance. So when a paint dries off, the thin layer that is formed, that is the protective coating, is basically the binder. Now let's see what is a solvent. Solvents also called dilutant or thinner. They majorly adjust the viscosity of the paint. Now, solvents control the flow and application properties. They can also affect the stability of the paint when in liquid state. Solvent is a volatile component and does not become a part of the film. It is a carrier for the non-volatile components like binder, pigments, fillers, etc. These volatile or these solvent impart their properties temporarily. Once the solvent has evaporated, the remaining paint is fixed to the surface. The component, the solvent, is an optional component. Some paints don't have any solvent. So what happens is when this binder and solvents are together in a paint, binder is what binds all the components, and solvent is which thins or it makes it easier to apply the paint. So when the paint dries off, only the binder film is left while all the solvent is evaporated off. Now, the major materials that are used as solvent are water, which is a main vehicle in water-based paints. Solvent-based paints have combination of solvents as the vehicle, including aliphatic, alcohols, etc. There are also organic solvents available like petroleum distillate, esters, glycol esters and the like. Now, next component is pigment. Pigment is the main component that renders color to the paint. Many experiments and research are being performed as we speak to find better, intense, safe and eco-friendly pigments. We will now see the most widely used pigments to render different types of different colors of paints. Pigments, you have natural pigments also and synthetic pigments also that can be used. Now, for black color, lamp black, vegetable black and graphite is used. For brown, raw umber, burnt umber pigments are used. For blue, Prussian blue, ultramarine blue pigments are used, while for red, Indian red, red lead, iron oxide is used. Iron oxide is a widely used pigment for red and shades of red. For yellow, you have chrome yellow, yellow ochre, and for green, you have green earth and chrome green. But the most important pigment of all is white. And titanium dioxide is the most widely used pigment for white color because world's primary pigment for providing whiteness, brightness and opacity. Also, it provides excellent hiding power and whiteness. It is also available as a solid form, as in a powder form, and also as liquid in a slurry form. Next component is additives. Additives impart or improve a certain property of the paint. They are usually mixed in very small amounts and yet give a very significant effect on the end product. Additives are used to do the following improvements like modify surface tension, improve flow properties, improving the finished appearance like making it glossy or matte or having a particular texture, improving pigment stability, controlling foaming, controlling skinning, texturizers, adhesion promoters, UV stabilizers. Even additives are used to make a paint antibacterial or hydrophobic. The next component is fillers. Fillers are a special type of pigment that serves to only thicken the film, support the structure of the paint and increase the volume. The major function of the filler, as the name suggests, is to fill the paint or increase the volume of the paint. Fillers are usually comprised of cheap and very inert materials such as talc, lime, clay, etc. Now, fillers do not have a very intense effect on the pigment or the color, but have a very moderate effect in the color of the final product, as in it decreases the saturation level of the pigment. So automatically it lightens the pigment little bit. Now let's see how paint is manufactured. The following are the various steps in paint manufacturing. First, raw material or making the paste, then dispersing the pigment, then thinning and canning. And in between these two, we also have lab testing. So raw materials. pigment manufacturers send bags of fine grain pigments to paint plants. There, the pigment is pre-mixed with resin or binder, a wetting agent that assists in moistening of the pigment, and one or more solvents and additives to form a paste. Now, how the paste is made? This involves mixing the pigment with resin, additives, and solvents to form a paste. Now, this additive, we use all additive except for dryers. Dryers are also a type of additive that impart, that improves the drying quality of paint. Usually, dryers are added at a later stage. So, in this stage, only pigments, resin, solvent, and additives are added. Next stage is dispersing the pigment. The paste mixture for most industrial is routed into a sand mill, a large cylinder that agitates tiny particles of sand or silica to grind the pigment particles, making them smaller and dispersing them throughout the mixture. The mixture is then filtered to remove the sand particles. So you see this one is a called a sand mill, in which the pigment and all the paste is mixed throughout, so to have a homogeneous disbursement of pigment. This sand mill is used for industrial paint demand. Instead of being processed in sand mills, up to 90% of water-based latex paints designed for use for individual homeowners or commercial use are instead processed in high-speed dispersion tank. So you see this is a high-speed dispersion tank. There, the pre-mixed paste is subjected to high-speed agitation by a circular toothed blade attached to a rotating shaft. This process blends the pigment into the solvent. Next stage is thinning of the paste. The thinner or the solvent or dilutant is added to the paste. Also, the additional additives like dryer is added to the paste. Whether created by a sand mill or a dispersion tank, the paste must now be thinned to produce the final product. The whole paste is transferred to a large kettle. It is agitated with proper amount of solvent and for the type of paint desired. Now, after the paint is thinned, we get the end product of the paint. A sample of the paint is taken for lab testing. The sample is tested for desired properties and characteristics required of the finished paint. If the sample is not up to the requirements and not up to the standards, it is taken back to the plant to add a more thinner or additive or any other compound according to the requirement. Finally, when the desired type of paint is, we receive the desired amount of paint, it is sent for canning. Now, paint canning is a completely automated process. The finished paint product is pumped into the canning room. For the standard 8-pint paint can available to consumers, empty cans are first rolled horizontally onto labels, then set upright so that the paint can be pumped into them. So, it's completely automated. A machine fills up the cans, a machine puts the lid on the cans, and the machine even seals up the cans. And even the cans are then taken for stocking and also sent to the godown. So, the whole process is completely automated. Now, this is the paint manufacturing layout. Let's just quickly summarize what we just learned. So, first you have pigment and fillers, binders, and your additives. Additives except dryers. These three things are first added and made a paste. Then they are sent to sand mill or dispersion tank and properly mixed. Then finally, they arrive at the thinning tank where dryers and solvents are mixed. This mixture is completely thoroughly mixed and then taken to screens from which you get a better fine paint, which is taken to the labeling machine or canning unit where it is scanned and sent. From this thinning tank, a portion of a sample of paint is taken for testing also. And if it's not up to the standards, again put into the thinning tank and solvents or dryers or additives are added to make it proper. Now, what is a good paint? So, what is a good paint? Good paint should be cheap. It should be easy and harmless to the user. That is, it should be non-toxic. It should retain its original color for a very long time. It should not fade away. It should be able to cover maximum area of the surface with minimum quantity. It should consistently provide easy workability. Painted surface should dry neither too slowly nor too rapidly. The thickness of the paint film should be adequate for good protection and decoration of the surface. The paint should form a hard and durable coat on the painted surface. Paint should not peel off from the painted surface. It should stick well to the surface and seal the porous substrata. Substrata meaning the surface on which the paint is coated on. It should be a good fire and moisture resistant. It should offer resistance to failure by checking, cracking and flaking. The painted surface should possess attractive and decorative and very pleasing appearance. And the paint film should withstand adverse weather effects for a long time without losing its gloss and painted, painted intensity. Now, these characteristics of a good paint will help us determine or choose a good paint, or this is a criteria of selection of a good paint. Now, let's see the different types of paints. Paint types. Paint have a wide variety of types for different types of applications. Now, we can classify paints based on the binder being used, the dilutant being used, the material on which the paint is going to be applied, and the function of the main component of the paint, and the location where the paint is applied. So, for binder, we have oil-based binders, we have epoxy binder, alkyd binder, acrylic binder. These are only few examples of binders. So, oil paints usually utilize a drying oil that oxidizes and hardens to form a tough elastic film when exposed to a thin layer of air. While alkyd paints have as a binder an alkyd resin, such as chemically modified soy or linseed oil. Latex paints or acrylic paints have an acrylic binder or acrylic resin that coalesces as water evaporates. So, when the water from the acrylic paints evaporates, the acrylic film is left, thin film of emulsion that is made of acrylic, acrylic resin is left on the painted surface. Epoxy paints, while epoxy paints have an epoxy resin as a binder, for increased epoxy binder gives increased resistance to corrosion, abrasion and chemicals. Now, based on the dilutant, you have water-based dilutant, organic solvent-based dilutant. We saw some examples of organic solvents in previous slides, which was ester and alcohol and all. Water-based, obviously, water-based dilutants have water as the base, water as the thinner. And they are mostly available in water or liquid form. The final product is available in liquid form. Also, certain water-based, one very good example of water-based paint is distemper. It is usually available in powdered form, which is mixed with water, required amount of water before it is applied. Now, based on materials, you have wall paints, metal paints and paints for wood walls. Again, distemper, primer, enamel, emulsion. You must have heard these words very commonly. Distemper, like I said before, is available in powder form. Primer, enamel, emulsion are all available in liquid forms. For metals, we have enamel paints. Also, we have primer, especially for metals. We have to apply the primer on the metals before we apply the enamels. For wood, we have varnishes. You already would have known varnishes are translucent type of a protective coating. They render a very little slight change of color to the natural wood. And then also you have wood paints, which are opaque, while varnish are translucent, almost transparent to translucent. Wood paints are completely opaque and they completely cover the natural grain of the wood. Then, based on the function of the component of the major component in the protective coating, you have primer, sealant, undercoat, finishing coat. Primer, as the name suggests, is the primary or the preparatory first coat. Sealant is the final coat, which completely seals off anything that seals off everything, or seals off or provides a physical barrier between the painted surface and the atmospheric factors. Undercoat are the coats between the primer and the final coat, and the final coat or finishing coat is the final coat that you see on any painted surfaces. Now, based on the location, you have interior paints and exterior paints. There are special types of paints, for example, fire-resistant paint, heat-resistant paint, anti-corrosive paint, antibacterial paint, which are widely used in hospitals, hydrophobic paints and bituminous paints and cement paint. Cement paint is currently trending kind of paint, which is widely used nowadays. It has a huge base of, it has major component in cement-based paint is your white cement. Now, let's see what we learned in this lecture. We have introduced to paints, what are the different components of paints, for the pigments of the paint that give color, solvents make it easier to apply, resin help it dry, and additives serve as everything from additive to antifungal agents to any improve any property. Then we saw how paints are manufactured, how it goes through several steps. Finally, we saw what are the characteristics of a good paint, which will help us determine or help us define a criteria for selecting a paint. And lastly, we saw the different types and different classification of paints. Now, based on your understanding of this lecture, can you answer the following questions? Name a minimum 5 special paints that you would have come across in your daily life. What additive is used to make a hydrophobic paint? Which is the most commonly used paint for exterior walls? With this, we have come to an end of this lecture. Thank you.